Welcome to another session of Mathematical Physics. Today we shall be discussing the Fourier integral transforms. So, as we have already discussed the Laplace transforms, and the Laplace transforms were used for the solution of the differential equations, and there the boundary conditions were given, and we were not one of the differential equation provided the boundary conditions were given, and we were not supposed to calculate the particular integral and the arbitrary constants. Similarly, the integral transforms are also used for the solution of the partial differential equations provided the boundary conditions are given. So, in this integral transform, we shall be mainly discussing about the Fourier integrals. So, integral transform f of s of a function fx is given with a kernel of k of sx. So every time when the integral transform is performed over a function, so a kernel k of sx is associated with it. So it takes the form that f of fx is equal to f of s, and it is that the integration is carried over fx, and the fx is multiplied with the kernel k of sx into dx, and the limits are from a to b. So this is the basic definition of the integral transform. So integral transform is that the function is multiplied with its kernel, and the integration is performed over the function and the kernel, and there are certain limits of the integration. So one of the example of the integral transforms we have already studied is the Laplace transform. So in the Laplace transform, you know that the Laplace was applied upon f of x, and it was represented by f of s, and it had the integration fx e to the power minus sx dx, and the limits were from 0 to infinity. So you can compare this with the basic definition of the integral transform. So you can see here that the function is associated with its kernel, and the limits a and b here are a is equal to 0 and b is infinity. So this is the Laplace transform. So now let us discuss about the Fourier complex transform. So when we talk about the Fourier complex transform, the kernel associated with the function is e to the power iota sx. In the subsequent slides, we shall be discussing how to calculate or how the Fourier complex transform, Fourier sine transforms, and Fourier cosine transforms are derived. So the Fourier complex transform, that is f of fx is equal to f of s, is equal to 1 by root 2 pi integration in minus infinity to plus infinity f of x e ki power iota sx. So the kernel associated with the Fourier complex transform is this e ki power of iota sx. So the function is multiplied with the kernel, and the integration is performed, and the limits here in the Fourier complex transform is minus infinity to plus infinity. Since we are able to give the formula for the Fourier complex transform, we are able to also calculate its inversion formula. So the inversion formula means now we shall be applying the integration over the f of s, and in the resultant we shall be getting the function itself. So the inversion formula is f of x is equal to 1 by root 2 pi integration over fx e to the power minus iota sx dx. So here the kernel associated with the inversion formula, that is the kernel associated with f of s, is e to the power minus iota sx. And the integration is performed over the s variable, and the limits are same as for the Fourier complex transform. The limits are minus infinity to plus infinity, and the same constant is multiplied in the Fourier complex transform and its inversion formula. You can see the constant is 1 by root 2 pi. Now let us discuss about the Fourier sine transform. So in the Fourier sine transform, the kernel is sine of sx. Since the formula is having the sine of sine term, so therefore this transform is regarded as the Fourier sine transform. So f of s of fx is equal to fss. f subscript of s. So it is root 2 by pi integration from 0 to infinity fx sine sx dx. And the inversion formula for the Fourier sine transform is that we get the function itself, that is f of x, and the integration is performed over the Fourier sine transform, multiplying the same kernel, that is sine of sx, into ds. And the limits of the integration are from 0 to infinity. On the same parallel lines of the Fourier sine transform, we are now going to discuss about the Fourier cosine transform. So in the Fourier cosine transform, the kernel associated with this is k of sx is equal to cos sx. So Fourier fc of fx is equal to fc s, which is equal to root 2 by pi integration from 0 to infinity fx cos of sx dx. And its inversion formula, again, the function itself is equal to root 2 by pi integration from 0 to infinity fc of s cos of sx ds. Now, since here the cos kernel is there, the cos term is there, therefore the Fourier transform is regarded as the Fourier cosine transform. And the inversion formula and the Fourier cosine transforms are very much related to each other. So, in this way, by using the basic definition of the integral transforms, we can easily remember how to calculate the various transforms. So now let us calculate the Fourier integral theorem. So in the Fourier integral theorem, the Fourier integral theorem states that the function, that is f of x, can be represented as 1 by pi integration from 0 to infinity, another integration from minus infinity to plus infinity, f of t cos of ut minus x dt into du, means that the function can be expressed as this part. And the function here was assumed to be that it was defined at a single valued, and it is single valued everywhere except at the finite points within the interval minus c to plus c. Also, the function is periodic outside minus c to c with period of 2c. So the function is having a period of 2c. If within the interval of 2c it is having a particular shape, so after in every 2c intervals it would be repeating its shape, so that the function remains periodic outside the interval minus c to c also. Thirdly, that the function we are choosing is a continuous function. Moreover, the first order derivative of the function f of x, that is f dash of x, is also continuous within the interval of minus c to plus c. And since the function is differentiable, so we find that the function converges also. It is converging to a definite value within the limits minus infinity to infinity, and it is absolutely integrable within the limits of minus infinity to plus infinity. Means that if we take that the interval c is increasing indefinitely or it is tending to infinity, then within the limits of minus infinity to infinity our function can be integrated also. So these are the various points that we have to consider for our function. So now let us see the proof of the Fourier integral theorem. So as we have already studied in another series, where we can express our function as a Fourier series within the interval of minus c to c. So the Fourier series of the function fx in the interval minus c to c is given by f of x is equal to a naught by 2 plus n summation n equal to 1 to infinity a n cos n pi x by c plus summation n equal to 1 to infinity b n sine of n pi x by c. So here, in this expansion series, we have a naught, an, and bn as constants, and these constants are represented by the equation that a naught is 1 by c integration minus c to c ft dt, an is 1 by c integration from minus c to c ft cos n pi t by c into dt, and bn is 1 by c minus c to c ft sine of n pi t by c into dt. So in each of these constant terms, we have a constant 1 by c outside. Since the period of the function of the interval is 2c, so it is always divided by half of the period. So half of the period is the C value. So we can see that each constant term A naught, An and Bn is divided by half period. So it is 1 by C integration from minus C to C. And in the An term, it consists of cos term and the Bn consists of the sine term. So now we shall be substituting the values of A naught, An, Bn in the equation number A. So we substitute the values. We have here A naught by 2. So when we substitute the value of A naught, it is 1 by C. So there is a 2 in the denominator. So the equation becomes 1 by 2C minus C to C integration ft dt. Then we have summation n equal to 1. And then it was An. So for An, we have substituted the value, that is 1 by C integration minus C to C ft cos n pi t by C. And here it is associated with cos of n pi x by c. So we have multiplied our An term with cos of n pi x by c into dt. Similarly, substituting the Bn value, we get summation n equal to 1 to infinity 1 by c minus c to c ft into sine of n pi t by c sine of n pi x by c into dt. So now what we do, we have our three terms. So we shall club our second and third term. So while clubbing the second and third term, there are certain terms which are common in both the terms, and we shall be taking out those common terms. So we find that summation n equal to 1 to infinity 1 by c integration minus c to c ft dt is common in the second and third term. So in the bracket, we are left out with cos of n pi t by c cos n pi x by c plus sine n pi t by c sine of n pi x by c. So you can very readily recognize it, that this is a formula of cos c plus sine c sine d, which is equal to cos of c minus d. So for this bracketed term, we have written it as cos of c minus of d. So we have written it as cos of n pi t by c minus of n pi x by c. So we have our resultant term. So the resultant term becomes 1 by 2c integration minus c to c ft dt plus summation n equal to 1 to infinity 1 by c integration minus c to c ft cos of n pi t by c minus n pi x by c into dt. So this can be written as, we can see here that n pi by c is common in the cos term. So we have taken this n pi c common term. So we get this equation. So now what we do, we see that there is something common between these two terms also. So we take out a common term of 1 by 2c integration of ft dt common. And what we are left out now, that in the bracket we get 1 for the first term because we have taken this term as common. So we get a 1. And since here it is 1 by c, you can see here it is 1 by c term, but we have taken 1 by 2c common. So we get a 2 factor in the numerator. So we get in the bracket as 1 plus 2 times summation n equal to 1 to infinity cos of n pi by c into t minus of x into dt. So this is the resultant term. So with these three terms that we started initially by substituting the values of a naught, an and bn, we are now comprised of this resultant term. And now we shall try to squeeze this result more, and we shall try to make it one single term. So what you do is that since the summation is consisting of the cos term, and we can also represent this one in terms of cos. So what we have done for the one term, we have written as cos 0 times pi by c into t minus x. So we have represented one in the same term as the summation cos term, because we know that cos 0 is 1. So for one, we have written cos 0 pi by c of t minus of x. So this is the first step we have done here. And secondly, what we have done, that we had the summations that was multiplied by 2. Since there were two summations, So what we have do, we had split the summation into two parts. So we have written here that it is n is equal to 1 to infinity cos of n pi by c t minus of x. And we could have also written it as n is equal to 1 to n equal to plus infinity. We could have broken up into two parts because the summation was two times. So now since we know that the cosine function is an even function, and if the argument is a negative argument, then also the answer remains the same, that is cos theta is equal to cos of minus theta. So now what we are trying to do, that we are changing the limits of the summation. Instead of carrying the summation over the positive integers, we are now carrying it over the negative integers, that is for n is equal to minus 1 to n is equal to minus of infinity. Because if we substitute the negative values also in the cos term, then also the answer remains the same and it would have no effect on the result. So what we have done, that instead of carrying it twice, we have replaced the n values by negative integers, that is n is equal to minus 1 to minus infinity, because cos of minus theta is cos theta. So now you can see it, that if we plot a number line, if we have a number line, so we have now for n is equal to 0 also, so this term will correspond to n equal to 0. Then we have the values from n equal to 1 to infinity. And also we have the summation for n is equal to minus 1 to n is equal to minus of infinity. So if we have the summations over the entire number line, that is from minus infinity to infinity, so we can express this bracketed term in one single term. Press our bracketed term in one single term, and what we have done, we have expressed it into this type, that it can be expressed as summation n is equal to minus infinity to infinity cos n pi by c into t minus of x of dt. So you can see this was the beauty of this derivation, that 1 plus 2 times n equal to 1 to infinity cos of n pi by c t minus x is expressed in this one single summation. By just converting the 1 can be expressed as cos 0 times pi by c t minus x, and the double summation is expressed as that the one summation is expressed over the positive integers and second is expressed over the negative integers, because using the property that the cos function is an even function, and for the negative arguments also we have the same result as the positive values. So we have the answer that f of x is equal to 1 by 2c integration minus c to c ft dt summation n is equal to minus infinity to plus infinity cos of n pi by c t minus x into dt. Now, as we have already discussed, that when we shall be considering the interval minus c to c, and we shall suppose that the interval will be increasing very indefinitely, or it shall be increasing to infinity. So if our interval is increasing to infinity, or it is increasing indefinitely, so let n pi by c is equal to u. We make a substitution that let n times pi by c is taken to be equal to du. Our n pi by c is equal to u, and one part of pi by c, that is pi by c, is taken as du, that is a smaller unit of u, that is du. So we have that the c interval is tending to infinity, therefore limit c tending to infinity pi by c summation minus infinity to infinity cos of n pi by c t minus x can be represented as that the summation is changed to the integration cos this n pi by c is replaced by u, and the term pi by c is replaced by du. You again, that this summation is integration because the limit c is tending to infinity. This cos n pi by c, this n pi by c term is to u, and the value of pi by c is changed to du. So we are making all these substitutions. So we are now having the terms. We had our function fx is equal to 1 by 2c integration from minus c to c ft dt summation n is equal to minus infinity to plus infinity cos n pi by c t minus x dt. So what we do, we multiply and divide it by pi. So we multiply and divide the equation by pi, and we retain this pi by c inside. So this pi by c is called as du, and 1 upon 2 pi is taken out. So you can see here, there is this 1 upon 2 pi with quantity. Then we have that the limit c is tending to infinity. So we have changed the infinity c values to infinity. So it is minus infinity to infinity f of t. Then this summation is again changed to integration, which is written as minus infinity to infinity cos. This n pi by c value is replaced by u. So we have cos u t minus x, and there was a term of pi by c left, and this pi by c is replaced by du into dt. So since you know that the cos function is an even function, there is that this cos function is an even function, and we have the limit from minus infinity to plus infinity. So for the even function, we can express this factor as 2 times the limit from 0 to infinity cos of u t minus x du. So this 2 and this 2 gets cancelled, and we get a resultant of 1 by pi 0 to infinity minus infinity to infinity st cos of u t minus x dt into du. So in this way, we are able to calculate the function fx, which is 1 by pi integral from 0 to infinity integral minus infinity to infinity ft cos ut minus x dt du. And this is our Fourier integral theorem. So let's now discuss the Fourier sine and cosine integrals. So since we have derived this equation in the Fourier integral theorem that fx is 1 by pi double integral, one is for 0 to infinity and the other is from minus infinity to infinity st cos of ut minus x dt into du. So we shall be deriving from this Fourier integral theorem our Fourier sine integrals and Fourier cosine integrals. So the Fourier sine integral takes the form of fx is equal to 2 by pi integral from 0 to infinity sine ux du, another integral from 0 to infinity ft sine ut dt. Whereas in the Fourier cosine integral, the sine terms are replaced by the cos terms. So it is 2 by pi integral from 0 to infinity cos ux du integral from 0 to infinity ft cos ut dt. So this is our Fourier cosine integral. So let's see the proof of the Fourier sine and cosine integrals. Now we have this definition of the fx from the Fourier cosine integral theorem. So we can now again apply the formula of cos c minus d here for the cos of u t minus x. So cos of u t minus xx is again expanded as cos ut cos ux plus sine ut sine ux, because we know that cos of c minus of d is cos c cos d plus sine c sine d. So we have cos ut cos ux plus sine ut sine ux. Now we shall split our integrals in two parts. So we get the integrals, that is 1 by pi 0 to infinity minus infinity to infinity ft cos ut cos ux du dt. And the second integral is now for the sine terms, which is 1 by pi integral from 0 to infinity minus infinity to infinity ft sine ut sine ux du into dt. So now we shall be considering two cases of our function, and from those cases we shall be able to derive our Fourier sine and cosine integrals. So let us see the two cases. So in case one, what we say that if our function is odd function, when our function, this f of t function, is an odd function, then obviously the function ft into cos of ut will also be an odd function, because we know that the cosine functions are even functions. So when an odd function is multiplied with the even function, the resultant is an odd function. So So ft cos ut will be odd function, and we know that for the odd functions, when we have the limits from minus a to a f of x dx, then the integral is equal to zero for a odd function. And for the even function, when the limits are from minus a to a f of x dx, which is equal to 2 times 0 to a f of x into dx. So this must be remembered, that from minus a to a f of x dx is equal to 2 times 0 to a f x dx for even function. And if it is an odd function, then our integral from minus a to a f x dx is equal to 0. So we know that our ft cos of ut function is an odd function. So therefore, the first integral will vanish. Therefore, the resultant will be equal to 0. So in the case 1, since this term will be equal to 0, we are left out with only the second part. So we get the resultant function as fx will be equal to 2 by pi integral from 0 to infinity sine ux du into 0 to infinity ft sine ut. Why? Because our minus infinity to infinity ft sine ut is an even function. So we can change this integral from 2 times 0 to infinity. So when we are replacing this integral for an even function, so we shall change the limits of this minus infinity to infinity as 2 times of 0 to infinity. So when we are replacing the limits from 2 times 0 to infinity for ft sine ut, so what we get here the resultant fx as 2 by pi integral from 0 to infinity sine ux du, because it is over the u variable and this integral is over the t variable. So we have retained the terms of only t variable, that is from limits from 0 to infinity ft sine ut dt. So this is the case 1 when the function was considered to be an odd function. Now let us consider the second case. So in the second case, we consider that when the function is an even function. So as you know that if this function is an even function, and we know that the cos term is also an even function. So both are even. So even multiplied by even is resultant is even function. So it will be an even function. But since our ft is an even function, but the sine term, the sine is an odd function. So when we multiply our even and odd function, so what we get in the resultant as odd function. So again, for the limit minus infinity to infinity, sine ut term will be equal to 0. So here the second term will vanish and we shall be left out with the first term. So what we have written here, we have written that ft sine ut is an odd function here, and hence the second integral from minus infinity to infinity ft sine ut sine ux du dt will be equal to 0, and we shall be left out with the first term. And since this is an even function, so now here we can change the limits from 2 times 0 to infinity ft cos ut. And here this 2 comes out of the integration and we get the result that f of x is 2 by pi integral from 0 to infinity cos ux du integral from 0 to infinity ft cos ut dt. So this is the Fourier cosine integral. So in this way, we are able to calculate the Fourier sine integral and Fourier cosine integral from the Fourier integral theorem. So I hope that you have all understood the derivation or the proof of the Fourier sine integral and Fourier cosine integral. So in the Fourier complex integral, our f of x is expanded as 1 upon 2 pi integral from minus infinity to infinity e to the power minus iota ux du integral from minus infinity to infinity ft e to the power plus iota ut dt. Since it is involving the complex term, this iota term, therefore this Fourier expansion is regarded as the Fourier complex integral. So now let us see the proof of the Fourier complex integral. So the Fourier complex integral is derived by using a property that we know that for the function is an odd function. If our function is an odd function, then we have this property that the integration from minus a to a fx dx will be zero. And let us choose a odd function. So we choose the odd function as sine of ut minus x. We know that the sine is an odd function. So in place of fx, we have substituted sine of ut minus x du, and the limits are chosen from minus infinity to infinity because the limits should be symmetric. Only the sign should change. So we have taken the limits from minus infinity to infinity, sine of ut minus x du equal to zero. Since the integral is equal to zero, if we multiply this integral with any of the term, it would not make a difference. So first we have multiplied our integral with another integral, that is 1 upon 2 pi integral minus infinity to infinity ft dt. And this integral value is equal to zero. So we had all, if we divide anything with this integral, that is not going to make any difference. So now again, we multiply with another factor, that is this iota term, the complex iota. So what we get as the expression, we get it as iota by 2 pi minus infinity to infinity integration ft dt. Again, integral minus infinity to infinity sine of ut minus x du equal to zero. So we have this term, and you know that you had from the Fourier integral theorem, you had the formula of fx, that was 1 upon pi integral 0 to infinity minus infinity to infinity ft cos of ut minus x dt du. So we have this formula from the Fourier integral theorem statement. Now what we do, we add both these statements A and B, because on the right hand side we have 0 in the A term, and on the right hand side of the B equation we have fx. So 0 plus fx will give us the value of fx. So here we get the value of fx to be equal to 1 upon 2 pi integral minus infinity to infinity, again integral minus infinity to infinity ft cos of ut minus x du dt, plus iota by 2 pi minus infinity to infinity ft dt integral from minus infinity to infinity sine of ut minus x du. On observing the equation clearly, we find that many terms are common in these two equations, in the two parts of fx. So we take out the common term. We have 1 by 2 pi integral minus infinity to infinity ft dt integral minus infinity to infinity minus infinity to infinity integration ft dt minus infinity to infinity du, and the common term is taken out, and we have the resultant bracketed term as cos of ut minus x plus iota sine of ut minus x. And we know the relation that cos theta plus iota sine theta is your e to the power iota theta, that is exponential iota theta. So for this cos of u plus iota sine of ut minus x, we can express this as e to the power iota ut minus of x. Now we have again divided our exponential in two parts, and since it will consist of two terms, e to the power iota ut and e to the power minus iota ux, and the second integral is over u variable, so we are taking out the e to the power iota ut is remained with dt term, and e to the power iota ux is retained with the du integral. So we have the equation that 1 upon 2 pi minus infinity to plus infinity e to the power minus iota ux du, and another integral is from minus infinity to infinity ft e to the power iota ut dt. So this is the derivation of the complex integral, and we get the result where our fx can be expanded as 1 by 2 pi integral minus infinity to infinity to the power minus iota ux du, integral minus infinity to infinity ft to the power iota ut into dt. So I hope you have understood how to express the function in terms of the complex terms, how that is the Fourier complex integral. And in the next module, we shall be discussing the problems related to the Fourier integral and Fourier sine integral, Fourier cosine integral, and the Fourier complex integrals. So thank you. Meet you again.